Morning, church. Good to see you all this morning. Thank you to those who found us online. Welcome. It's wonderful to be here with you all this morning. Let's prepare our hearts for prayer. Join me in prayer, please. Father God, we want more of you. Too often we choose to pursue momentary things and push you aside. Would you forgive us? Would you change us? We don't want to live a life that isn't focused on you. As we prepare for worship today, Father, would you join us? We invite you in. We love you. Please join us. Silence the noise in our lives, Father, and help us to hear more of you. Show us what steps we need to take to refocus our hearts, our minds, our spirits, our souls on you alone. Search our hearts. Know us. Clean out our lives, Father. Help us to see anything that offends you and make us more like you, Father God. Show us the path that leads to life. Fill us with the joy of your presence. We love you. We choose to fix our eyes on you. In Jesus' name we pray. And the church said, amen. Let's stand and worship together this morning.
As you're singing these songs, if you just look at the words, sometimes it becomes easy to sing, but if you look at the words, they can really have a lot of meaning to your life.
I can see waters raging at my feet. I can feel the breath of those surrounding me. I can hear the sound of nations rising up. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. I can walk down down this dark and painful road I can face. Every fear of the unknown I can hear. All God's children singing out, we will not be overtaken, we will not be overcome. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that commands the dead to wake, lives in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea, lives in us, lives in us. He lives in us, lives in us. We have hope that his promises are true in his strength. There is nothing we can't do. Yes, we know there are greater things in store. We will not be overtaken, we will not be overcome. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that commands the dead to wake, lives in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea, lives in us, lives in us. He lives in us, lives in us. Greater is he that is living in me. He's conquered our enemy. No power of darkness, no weapon prevails. We stand here in victory. No power of darkness, no weapon prevails. We stand here in victory, in victory. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that commands the dead to wake, lives in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea, lives in us, lives in us. He lives in us, lives in us. He lives in us, lives in us.
You may be seated. As we come to this time of prayer and sharing, I invite us all to lift our voices, fill us in on how we're all doing and what we see God doing in our lives in and around us, and to offer a prayer as well. It's sort of the concert of prayer and a time of sharing blended together. I just wanted us to hear more from each other. And for those watching online, you can email me at pastortripp@greenwoodschurch.com just to let us all know how we're all doing. So I just lift this time to us, and I'll close us in prayer.
I pray for a young person at the treatment center where I work who, while under the influence, hit a person, and the person died this week. I pray that you would be with the family of the victim, and Lord, with this young man who is experiencing so much remorse, so much hopelessness, so much fear. He needs you right now. He needs to know that you are by his side, that you are standing with him. He needs to know, Lord, that your forgiveness extends to the uttermost situations that we face, that we're responsible for. I pray, Lord, that he would turn to you to ask you for forgiveness, that he would know your peace, and that he would accept the consequences of his behavior. I pray this in Jesus' name.
Heavenly Father, I just thank you for bringing old friends back to church this morning. It's a joy to see people we haven't seen in such a long time. Lord, it gives me personally such a sense of hope for your church here at Greenwoods, that we will be restored at some point soon to the work that we were called to do in this area, to be a lighthouse of your faith to those who are part of our church family, and especially to those around us who need to know you, Lord Jesus, as their Savior. And in your name, Lord.
Father, I just want to thank you, too, for being able to gather here with the church family, and I just pray that the members and new members who might know about us or hear about us want to come and join us, Lord, those listening, to feel like they can be safe and comfortable coming here, gathering in person. I just want to thank you for even being able to gather with my family. We have a kind of a big month in July, and we're going to be celebrating this afternoon, actually. Family's getting together. Our son has a birthday tomorrow, and our son-in-law had a birthday yesterday. My daughter-in-law's birthday's in a week. And Lonnie and her husband have an anniversary in about a week and a half, so we're just kind of coming together to celebrate all of it, and just so grateful to be able to do that. And some of the other things that we always took for granted, Lord, so help us to appreciate this time, being able to join, just be grateful, Lord, for the many gifts that we have. We have it all because of you. We thank you, Lord. Thank you this day. Amen.
Lord, I pray for our persecuted brothers and sisters around the world. We're facing terrible and frightening situations. Ask, Lord, that you would give them boldness, courage, bravery, steadfastness, forgiveness, and joy.
Father in heaven, you are Lord God Almighty. You are in control. You never take a vacation. You never close your eyes. You never sleep. You know what's going on in this world, Lord. believe that you will protect us as your people. And I pray, Father, that those that are not here, Lord, would understand that. That we would return to gather as a group of saints, which your word tells us to do. Heavenly Father, I know there's fear due to this virus going around. I know that, Lord. But I truly believe that you love us and you will protect us, and not a single sparrow will fall from the sky without your knowledge. So I truly believe that your protection is upon us, and that we need to gather together. We need to see that we're actually human, that we actually have voices and we have eyes. Lord, help us to come back together. Help us, Lord, to show your strength through our weaknesses. Father God, I just pray, Lord, that this church and every other church, Lord, that is having a problem of small attendance, that the people would really understand, Father, that you are truly in control and you are Lord God Almighty, not Lord God Minister. Father, pray in Jesus' name that you would touch the souls and the spirits of every single person that is here and every single person that is not here, Lord, and let them know your love and your protection and your grace and your mercy in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord, thank you for this beautiful misty day. Thank you for bringing us all together. We do pray, Lord, as we've said so many times, we pray for more and more, coming here, being together, seeing each other, hugging. So wonderful, your beautiful house. We just thank you. We pray for more and more people to be vaccinated, those who can, so that more and more of us can be together, to get out, come back to sharing in you. I do thank you for being online. Thank you, and we love you. Pray that you keep us safe and sound and healthy. In your name, Jesus, thank you.
Father, I lift up my grandson, Sam, who is approaching his 18th birthday this week and has had quite a hard time over the last year. And is having some confusion about what his future might hold and how to pursue his life right now. I just pray you would strengthen him to the tasks that you put before him. And, you are not unknown to him. We've spent a lot of time with Sam, and we pray that he would continue to know that he is loved and cared for by you and by his family, and that there would be a great strength in that going forward. I also pray for all the children in this congregation and the children going back to school in September and in the private schools, that you would particularly watch over them and give us the chance to do everything we can do to protect them from contagion. Help us to love them that way and care for them, knowing that you're watching over the whole thing. You do have a plan for all of us. But give us hearts of care for those who are vulnerable. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Lord, we pray for Pastor Drew's home, family. Pray for that bathroom to get in quickly now. So that their home may turn to normal. We thank you for all that you're doing and all that you've done. We pray for the whole country to come together now quickly. Thank you, Father.
That's my cue. Father God, thank you for the words of the Lord's Prayer that your Son gave us. May they be fresh, may they be new to us now as ever, Father God. May these words unite us as your people, connect us to you, connect us to each other, Lord, as the living body of Christ, and then help us to connect to the communities around us, Father God. We pray these words right now as your people, as your church, and we declare them, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Just wanted to share, Margot, thank you for this note from Isabella Cho. A former Simon's Rock student who used to attend here. She just says that she loves us and misses the Greenwoods community. And that's another community that we can pray for as well. We'd love to have Simon's Rock people from there feel safe enough to come here. So we can pray that transportation would be opened up, that the campus would, security would feel comfortable allowing students, and from Berkshire School too. Check the website for any dates. Anyone have an announcement? Anything they'd like to share at this point? No? Wonderful to see you all this morning. Yeah, go ahead.
Isn't 5/8.
It is?
Yeah.
That's not on my calendar. Yes, it's Sayana's birthday in 5 days. McKenna's birthday was the end of last month. Little girls are growing up. It's crazy. Yeah, Jane.
Sunday morning presentation, but we'll do one by Zoom. Unlike with Rachel, we'll post the Zoom link on the weekly email. All right, we don't have to be worried about government situations with Mexico. So with Rachel, I was a little disappointed we didn't have more participants, but we needed to secure that. We need to be careful with the Zoom link because of government concerns. So we'll post the Zoom link, and we hope that some folks will join and see what's happening at El Rancho Del Rey.
Thank you, Jane. Was that? Yikes. Jane, just to reiterate, Sue Mino, El Rancho Del Rey, there'll be a Zoom meeting in the next month. Check the pastoral updates for the link for that. I'll be sure to include that and announce that so that we all can can join. So thank you, Jane. Well, good morning, everyone. It's a privilege and a blessing to be here. We're in chapter 3 of our Ecclesiastes series, Into the Mist, a walk through Ecclesiastes. Before we jump in, I'd just like to take a moment and invite anyone to let me know how we're doing with this series. My email is pastortripp@greenwoodschurch.com. I'd love to hear from those watching online. I'd just love to hear feedback. So far, I mean, is there something in this series so far that's confirmed something for you? Or is there something new you've learned? Or is there something helpful? Or maybe something from you've seen from a different perspective and it changed the way you thought? Maybe there's some things you don't agree with. Just let me know. I'd really love to hear feedback. And if anyone would like to say anything now, I can open it up for a few moments. Does anyone have any concerns or anything they'd like to share? Yeah, Janet. Okay.
Just that the clip that you showed from the movie The Chosen, where Jesus said, "Do you want to be healed? Look at me." Personally, that made such an impact on me. And
praise God. Amen. Thank you. Jane.
I liked the concept of the talk about fleeting and mist and so forth. It made more sense to me than the vanity. You know?
Yeah.
Vanity, all this vanity that I grew up with, it's like, oh, that's different. And it's helped me see what's here in a little different light.
Praise God. Wonderful. Scripture should always be speaking to us. It's alive. Amen. Right? So thank you for, and please continue to share with me. As we look at chapter 3 today, we're in chapter 3, we're going to encounter a repeated pattern that the author used in chapters 1 and 2. As you'll recall, in chapters 1 and 2, the author presents the king's problem with life under the sun. Chapter 1, starting in verse 2 to 11, the king, speaking like a king like Solomon, describes the failure of life apart from God. And then in verses 12 to 18, we see that apart from God, wisdom fails. In chapter 2, verses 1 through 11, the king describes how his search for any pleasure and meaning at all in life without God fails. And thus his conclusion at this point is, without God, life is too uncertain, random, to bring any sense of purpose, meaning, or pleasure. Everything is fleeting. This reminds me of a quote from artist Pierre Renoir. And he said this, about 1883, something like a break occurred in my work. I had reached the end of Impressionism, and I had come to realize that I did not know how to paint or draw. In short, I found myself in a deadlock. Well, this is precisely where our author ended up at this point. So last week, beginning in chapters 2, starting in 24 to 26, we finally encountered God. What a breath of fresh air that was. Hallelujah. And in those verses, the author now proposes an alternative. The alternative to the life he proposed back in chapter 1, a life of faith in God. And today we'll see the conclusions that the author comes to in this search. And here's a hint, it's not nearly as bleak. In fact, it's much, much more optimistic, as we'll see. I've asked Warren and Janet Prindle to read today's passage. So as they come forward, we're looking at Ecclesiastes, we're looking at the whole third chapter today, verses 1 to 22. If you open up your Bibles to the middle, you might find yourself in the Psalms. Keep turning to Proverbs. Ecclesiastes is right after that. So, thank you, Prindles.
Ecclesiastes chapter 3. for everything, there is an appointed time and an appropriate time for every activity under heaven.
A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot what was planted.
A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up.
A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance.
A time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing.
A time to search and a time to give something up as lost. A time to keep and a time to throw away.
A time to reap and a time to sow. A time to keep silent and a time to speak.
A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace.
What benefit can a worker gain from toiling? I have observed the burden that God has given to people to keep them occupied.
God has made everything fit beautifully in its appropriate time, but he has also placed eternity in the human heart. Yet people cannot discover what God has ordained from the beginning to the end of their lives.
I have concluded that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to enjoy themselves as long as they live, and also that everyone should eat and drink and find enjoyment in all his toil, and these things are a gift of God.
I also know that whatever God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken away from it. God has made it this way so that everyone will fear him. Whatever exists now has already been, and whatever will be has already been. For God will seek to do again what has occurred in the past.
I saw something else on earth. In the place of justice, there was wickedness, and in the place of fairness, there was wickedness.
I thought to myself, God will judge both the righteous and the wicked, for there is an appropriate time for every activity, and there is a time of judgment for every deed.
I also thought to myself, it is for the sake of people, so God can clearly show them that they are like animals.
For the fate of humans and the fate of animals are the same. As one dies, so dies the other. Both have the same breath.
There is no advantage for humans over animals, for both are fleeting.
Both go to the same place. Both come from the dust, and to dust both return.
Who really knows if the human spirit ascends upward and the animal spirit descends into the earth?
So I perceive there is nothing better than for people to enjoy their work, because that is their reward. For who can show them what the future holds?
Thank you, Warren and Janet. It's nice to hear a full passage of scripture, isn't it? And, thank you. You both read beautifully. In the late 1800s, Reverend James Langdon Hill said this, "Life eternal, how shall I express my thought of it? It is not mere existence, however prolonged and free from annoyance. It is not the pleasures of the senses, however vivid. It is not peace, it is not happiness, it is not joy, but it is all these combined into one condition of spiritual perfection, one emotion of indescribable rapture, the peace after the storm has gone by, the soft repose after the grief is over, the joy of victory when the conflict is ended." This is a beautiful summary, and it really captures our opening verses in this chapter. Commentators and scholars throughout the ages marvel at the mastery of poetry of verses 1 through 8 of Ecclesiastes. And I'm sure some of us already hear the melody of the Byrds' famous incorporation of these verses in their song from the 1960s, "To Everything, Turn, Turn, Turn." So in order to describe the totality of something, ancient Near East culture frequently implemented what literary scholars today call maresmus. The Bible is no exception. We still use it today, in fact. "I've searched high and low for my keys, and I just can't find them. meaning I've literally searched everywhere I could possibly think of for my stinking keys. Or this, for example, I say this to my daughters frequently, I love you to the moon and back. Or how about Psalm 103, verse 12, he has removed our sins as far from us as the east is from the west. You know, from one end of time to the other and everywhere in between, Jesus has forgiven our sins. Hallelujah. Amen. So the author weaves together a rich woven tapestry of time, seasons of life under heaven. Another tool the author uses to communicate the totality of human life is the number seven. This is especially significant in Scripture. In the first eight verses, we count 14 pairs of times and seasons. And if we counted them all individually, there'd be 28 of them. So all multiples of seven, which in Scripture speaks to completion, perfection, holiness, and blessing. The prime example is God creating all things, everything, in 7 days back in Genesis. Here's what another commentator says. It's important to remember that it is not the individual elements of themselves that are important in verses 1 through 8, but the elements taken together as an overall description of life. It's not even that each individual life is in view. Not every person, for example, will find that killing or war feature as part of his or her existence. There's no prescriptive aspect to this list of opposites. It's simply generalized, descriptive, an account of the kinds of things that make up human existence as it can be observed. Human beings in general spend their days in the ways described in the activities that lie between the poles of activity represented in these opposites. So the point of our passage today is summed up in Psalm 31:15, which says to God, "My times are literally in your hands." You know, we may never fully understand the various times of life, but in all time, we should be content in God's sovereignty. Yes? Amen? Back in the first sermon in this series, I said this. Here's the challenge for us as God's people. God wants us to bring everything we're feeling to Him. The questions, the frustration, the hurt, the pain, even the doubt. And I mean this, the challenge He asks of us as we do this is to remember who He is and whose we are. No matter life seasons, bring it all to Him, friends. Wrestle with Him even. He wants us to come to Him as we are. But at the same time, we're to remember and trust in His sovereignty. Yes, that's the challenge of us as God's people. He is good. He is in control, even though it looks like He isn't at times. But that will never change. Amen? I have a lot of favorite scriptures that I've shared with you, but another one of them is verse 11 in this chapter. God has made everything fit beautifully in its appropriate time. And I love this, but He has also placed eternity in the human heart. That's His image in us, a bit of heaven in us, His children. I love that. In the three-act play, Our Town, by great American playwright and novelist Thornton Wilder, which it actually won the 1938 Pulitzer Prize for drama, one of the characters in the third act says this, "I don't care what they say with their mouths. Everybody knows that something is eternal. And it ain't houses, it ain't names, and it ain't earth, and it ain't even stars. Everybody knows in their bones that something is eternal. And that something has to do with human beings. There's something way down deep that's eternal in every human being. You know, deep down, deep within our being, we all know something is eternal, yes? No matter what we believe or choose not to believe, we don't need to have a reason for believing. We just know that something is eternal intuitively. Yet so many, you know, especially today, fail to grasp a hold of what that eternal something is. But we know, don't we, friends? We may not be able to explain it fully, We may not be able to understand it all. I certainly don't understand it all. We may never understand it. But we trust in the one who set it there in each of us in the first place. Amen? The end of our passage today poses what seems to be a timeless concern. And historian John Goldingay sums it up beautifully. He says, a community's life is designed to be based on people caring for one another, supporting one another, doing right by one another, protecting one another. That's faithfulness. The people with power in a community are supposed to exercise their authority in a way that expresses and supports such faithfulness. But members of communities often care chiefly for themselves, and people in power commonly use their power to encourage the strong to take advantage of the weak rather than protecting them. Authorities and people collude in faithlessness. We see that everywhere. But once again, the challenge of us as God's people is to trust in God's sovereignty. Amen? God will undoubtedly and most assuredly faithfully respond to the faithlessness that seems to abound all throughout human history. The purpose of our journey through life seasons are fording the current of time is to continue to walk on more and more into that eternity stamped within us as God's people. Yes, there will be times of joy, times of weeping, times of gathering and times of letting go, times of loss, times of wailing, and there will be times of dancing, I promise. But we have a God who is sovereign over all time, amen? And we have each other to dance together as the body of Christ through every season of this life. And as we dance more and more confidently in who we are and whose we are, that kingdom light and purpose shines more and more brilliantly through us to those around us. And thus, the divine dance continues, drawing us more and more into the Father's loving embrace. Amen? As we close today, just let this next song be your prayer. You know, acknowledging and yielding to God's sovereignty, His divine dance. Let's just sit. Feel free to stand or sit, whatever. Let's just listen and pray together.
If you're troubled, heavy-hearted, come to Jesus and find your peace. If you're run down, empty-handed, come to Jesus and find your strength. He is hope for the hopeless, rest for the weary, help for the hurting. He is mending the broken, bearing the burdens, all that you're needing. He is. If you're wandering and find His grace, He is hope for the hopeless. Comforter, Counselor, Prince of Peace, Author and Maker of everything, Defender, Deliverer, King of Kings. He is Helper and Healer forevermore, Savior and Shelter through every storm, My Refuge, Redeemer, and Lord of Lords. He is Child of Heaven and Son of Man, Provider, Protector, the Great I Am, Alpha, Omega, Beginning and End. He is Hope for the hopeless, Rest for the weary, Help for the hurting. He is Mending the broken, Bearing the burdens, All that you're needing. He is All that you're needing. He is.
Let's pray. Father God, when the world divides us, come Holy Spirit, make us one. When the world calls us orphaned, come Holy Spirit, make us family. When the world leads us astray, come Holy Spirit, call us home. Come Holy Spirit, come fill this place. Bless these gifts that we bring, whether we brought them with us or mailed them in, whether we've given them online. We just pray, Father God, that you would bless all of us who will be served and all of those who will be served because of our giving. Build up your church here at Greenwoods, Father. We bring these offerings and we offer them because we hope for more of you in the days ahead. We pray for a stronger church and contribute to a more compassionate world and invest in more peace in this world. And as we give, as we let go of that which you've given us, Father, and trust that you're only going to fill us up again, would you shape us through our giving into a people more faithful to your word and a people full of joy and good news. We dedicate everything we give. We dedicate our lives to you, Father, all that we are. Bless the lives of your children. And the church said, Amen. Let's stand and we'll sing our last song together.
Good.
May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accordance with Christ Jesus and the Holy Spirit, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Go in his peace. Amen.